Dr. Jitendra Singh, the Honorable Minister of State, very progressive and very forward-looking minister who has devoted himself to the cause of Northeast. May I request you, sir, to kindly deliver the keynote address.
Thank you, Amitabh Kanji, for your very kind words of introduction. Seated on the dais here, our Vice Chairman, Dr. Rajiv Kumar Ji, Chief Minister of Assam and also Chief Host, as Amitabh described him, and to me also my chief friend, Sarvanand Sonwal Ji. Also, because over the last 6 years, Guwahati has virtually become a second home to me. Virtually every third day I am here, and even if I have to go to any other state, I have to cross through Sarvanand Sonwal's territory without often seeking his permission. So that is the kind of graciousness with which we have shared this relationship. Our senior most member in this room, the Chief Minister of Mizoram, Mr. Zoram Thanga, and from the pearls of wisdom that he distributed some time back, you must have realized the wisdom that comes with age. And since I have made it a principle for myself to try to learn one new thing each day, so one new thing which I am going back from here learning is that regardless of whether you know a language or not, that is not important. You should know what is important to know in that language. And even without being a Hindi-speaking person, if he says that I know very well what it means to say Mia Bibi Razi, I don't know how many sitting under this roof actually have been able to follow this dictum. If we had followed it, we would have today been as youthful looking and as energetic as Mr. Zoram Thanga. Our young friend and Chief Minister from Arunachal, Pema Khundu Ji. Our Chief Minister from Tripura, Biplav Kumar Ji. Prem Singh Tamang, the Chief Minister of Sikkim. Our energetic Finance Minister of Assam, Hemant Sharma. UN Resident Coordinator, officers from different northeastern states. I should have mentioned, but it's never too late, Dr. Pal, the member of Niti Aayog, also sitting over here. Ladies and gentlemen, nearly 6 years ago, when I was listening to what Sarvanand Sonowal was saying and others said, and what occurred to me was that when we came here for the first time, and when this government came in 2014 and we came into Northeast, actually led by Prime Minister Modi, Northeast was at that time known for reasons other than what it is known today for, and it made news not always for good reasons. It was known for violence, it was known for protracted blockades, it was known for development which was virtually come to a standstill. And if it made news, it made news for corruption cases, and it made news for some of our children living outside the northeastern region suffering from an unreasonable treatment and feeling harassed. And therefore it was like beginning from a scratch. And somehow I think it was destiny that I got associated with donor and Northeast region, because honestly speaking, prior to that I have never been to Northeast, because I thought my profile was such that I was not actually meant to be ever given an assignment like this. And I think the most amusing instance of this is that when I first time landed in Guwahati, I dressed myself in full woolens, having read that Brahmaputra was the largest, one of the largest rivers of world, and we were going to land by its side, so how cold it would be in the month of November. So having begun that journey, I think sometimes it's also an advantage when you begin your journey from ignorance. You have everything new to learn. You don't come with a pre-learnt mind. And that's how this commitment and this journey led by Prime Minister Modi began. And today, I can say with all the confidence at my command, one of the earlier statements made by Prime Minister Modi was that we have to bring Northeast at par with some of the more developed parts of India. And we have actually lived the talk, or walked the talk, as they say in English language, which I'm sure Mr. Zoram Thanga will bear me out, notwithstanding his own views about this. The transformation that has happened over the last 6 years is to be seen to be believed. Possibly many of us sitting in this room are not able to realize, because we see it happening day to day. When you see something gradually evolving, don't realize the change happening, as you don't realize the change in your face. When you meet a college friend after 30 years, you think, oh, ye itna buda ho gaya. Without realizing that he's also come over the same. But what happens, and that's why we are not able to realize, because we are going through it. We are going through it very gradually. This is happening each moment, moment to moment, day to day, night to night, month to month, year to year, we don't realize. But out of my curiosity, I have been consciously, because being a student of science, I always like to gather evidence for whatever view I tend to hold in my mind. I have been asking people from outside Northeast, what is your opinion? What did you see? And you must, and I'm sure I'll advise or suggest to Sarvananji also, we could have a kind of a visitor's book at airport. The tourists and the other, even government officers coming here after a period of 5 or 6 years, will tell you what it is all about. Very recently we had some of the officers from PIB, who are actually the newsmen. Some of them had just about the, on the verge of retirement, and they took an LTC and came here. And they said, we were amazed the manner in which we could drive from Guwahati to Shillong. It never happened 5 years ago. So because they have come after a gap, that's why I said, you see a friend after 20 years, arre sahab, ye beda garak ho gaya iska. And you don't realize ki aapka bhi waisa hi hua. Because we have marched with these times. But those who can see the change will tell you that it is, I said, very probably seen to be believed. Unless you see, you would not be able to believe it. And I think the single most credit for this, as has been said one after the other by Sonwalji, by Biplavji, to the maximum extent goes to Prime Minister Modi. And his personal outreach, personal indulgence. I was the first one who pointed out in a write-up, and then it was picked up repeatedly, that in 5 year term of his first tenure as Prime Minister, he travelled to Northeast more than 30 to 35 times. That may be more than the number of visits paid by all the predecessors put together, including the immediate predecessor who happened to be an MP from Assam. So, I mean, unless we actually realize the depth of this, it's difficult to appreciate. The ministerial outreach which happened under his guidance, every fortnight 8 ministers traveling to Northeast, which means 1 minister in each. And then I suggested to my colleagues in the Ministry of Donor, why not we have a rotating camp secretariat? Because when I was given this charge of donor, I actually didn't know where the office of the ministry is located in New Delhi. And I had to ask a couple of people, they told me it was in Vigyan Bhavan. When I said I have been to Vigyan Bhavan for ample number of times, I never came across anything like ministry board over there. And they said, no, there is something called an XE, where it is located. So I asked myself, if I am not able to locate the office of the Ministry of Northeast, what would be the fate of those who come from Northeast? So we started hit upon this idea because this is a pattern which was followed in the British Raj also when they had larger provinces. They had a large central province. They had a large undivided Madras state which included today's Andhra, today's Karnataka, today's Tamil Nadu. We had whole of the Bengal state and they would move. We had whole of Punjab beginning from Lahore up to Simla because that was part of Himachal and everything was part of that. So they would move to Simla in some of them. So some of them would sit in Nagpur in the undivided Bombay state which included today's Maharashtra. So why should not be? Because this is something like that. This is the only region-based ministry in the government of India and you could treat it as a huge, huge province. And therefore, I have to compliment and also thank my colleagues in the Ministry of Donor that without any complaints or grudge, they decided to undertake this inconvenience of setting up ministry office by rotation in each of the 8 states. And I think this is a unique example followed for the first time in India in the last 70 years. The population of Northeast is just 3 to 4% of the total population of India. And why I'm saying so is, I think those like me who are engaged in electoral politics would realize what it means to give this extra thrust. It's not an easy job. It requires tremendous amount of courage for any government at the center. Zoram Thanga Sahab has his own complaints, but let's not forget, the first ever citrus food park in India, not only in India, in Indian subcontinent, was set up in Mizoram 2 years back with Israeli collaboration. Any politically clever government will say, meri constituency mein laga do, prime minister ki constituency mein laga do, donor minister ki constituency mein laga do, 4 vote milenge. Unless we get elected, we would not be coming back here. Unlike many of the officers who have a secure 35 years, we have only 5 years. Because I have always spoken from heart, and unless we realize this, because living in a progressive India, we cannot understand the importance of this. Mizoram just would elect one MP, doesn't make any difference. It can neither make a government at center nor mar a government at center, nor make a prime minister nor mar a prime minister. But still, Prime Minister Modi taught us, we would make up for the lapses of the past. We would give justice where it was not provided. We would reach out to the deprived, to the last man in the last queue, those who were left out of priority for other considerations. And therefore, and then let the people of India judge whether they deserve us or not. And they did deserve, that's why Modi, as Prime Minister, got elected multiple times with a higher mandate this time. Because the voter himself also has become much more awakened and deciphering. It's a country with 70% population of youth, and they are the key voters. They don't even agree with their parents' political preferences. So you must understand how much of effort, commitment has gone behind this. Roads, railways, airport. There were at least 2 states in Northeast, I just take 2 minutes, come to sustainable goal and then wind up, which had never seen a train. Arunachal Pradesh, Meghalaya. Today Pemaji is there, he will bear me out. We have an Arunachal Express which was flagged off by Prime Minister. And we look forward to have a Rajdhani one day from Itanagar. I mean, this could have been done in the last 60 years. What was preventing? Nothing. It was the misplaced priorities or maybe deliberately placed priorities because, as I said, we did not act politically clever. We acted politically innocent and tried to reach out where it was required. Our Arunachal Pradesh train shuru ho jaye, toh humare, agar humne, we have to see from the point of view of the political party that we belong to, तो कितने अधिक एमपी आ जाएंगे साहब? So this we have tried to change the political culture in this country. That is, I think, the biggest contribution. Northeast, as I was saying the other day, has not only emerged as a development model under Modi for rest of India to follow in the UT territory, which is newly created Jammu Kashmir. PM himself said we should try to focus on Jammu Kashmir the same way as we did in Northeast, because it has emerged as a development model. But I would say it has also emerged as a model of a new political culture which the 21st century India will have to realize. As far as railway roads are concerned, when I came to Northeast and I put a small note, I said Northeast has contributed a new phrase to the English vocabulary, and that is orphan roads. Because the roads between the two states were never being owned. Each state looked at each other, who would budget the upkeep of the road. And for the first time in the history of independent India, a regional road corporation was constituted, known as Northeast Road Development Scheme, with a special focus on these so-called orphan roads. Airports. Guwahati today is an international airport. This has happened only in the last few years. Arunachal never had an airport, can you imagine? As Chief Minister Kundu ji was rightly pointing out, it's not only the northeastern state, it is the most eastern of the northeastern. It is the northeastern of the northeastern. And strategically so sensitive, even if not from the tourist point of view, the visitor's point of view, at least strategically and from the defense point of view, we needed to have an airport there. Not now. 60 years ago, if not 60 years, at least 50 years ago after the China War of 62. Why didn't the government think about it? I mean, this is something which the future researchers and the students of political science will have to determine. Don't you think after the Himalayan debacle of 1962, when NEFA got to be known all over the world, a thought should have been given to set up an airport at Arunachal? And if not, what were the reasons? If I elaborate on this, this will make news for unflattering reasons. But I'm sure we can go home and think. Today, the work is going on. That's only happened in the last 2 years, 3 years. The land is acquired. Similarly, in every sphere, I would say, we were lacking, we were standstill, and we were complacent. Because, and the people here, being very civilized and by grooming very restrained, had got learned to live with that fate. But the kind of psychological barriers and gap it was creating was not being realized. I traveled to those parts of Northeast where very few had ever visited. When I went to East Khasi Hill, James is there. So they told me, here the Chief Minister also comes only at the election time. So why did you come? Because I went there to meet the family of Tiroti Singh. Tiroti Singh is one of the earliest freedom fighters. Those living in Meghalaya, Northeast also would not know. He died somewhere in 1830s, even before the First War of Independence. Chota sa Raja tha. When the British came here, he said, I will not leave my territory, whatever you want to do. They insisted. When he didn't agree, threw him into the prison, he died there. So how much of effort, how much of hard work, and how much of commitment and sincerity has gone behind bringing about this change? We went there to, again to Mewale, that Jawai, I am coming there again in week's time. वो कह लगे जी यहां मंत्री पहली बार आया कोई सेंटर से सो यूनियन मिनिस्टर पहली बार आया तो मैंने कहा आइए देखिए कान चार हैं कि दो हैं नाक दो हैं कि एक है आंखें तीन हैं कि तीसरी आंख खुली है एंड टुडे दैट बैरियर इज गॉन जो हिंटरलैंड मेनलैंड ये लैंड इट वॉज अमेजिंग वाई शुड यू टॉक ऑफ हिंटरलैंड मेनलैंड वेन यू से इट्स पार्ट ऑफ इंडिया. Because that kind of subconscious feeling was there. And very relevant to this evening's program, let's not forget, Niti Aayog Forum for Northeast was also constituted by Prime Minister Modi. For the first time, Niti Aayog has an exclusive forum for any region of the country which is Northeast. And when it was constituted, one of the first things that I told Dr. Rajiv Kumarji, I said, now the only issue is that you will start getting demand from other parts of the country, that we should also have a Niti Aayog forum for our region if Northeast has one. And even if it had not been constituted, I don't think anybody would have complained, because nobody had this demand in mind. Nobody asked for it, neither at the government level nor at the public level. But the leader is one who leads, not who is led. Led to sare ho jate hain. Bahar dharna ho gaya, pradarshan ho gaya, protest ho gaya, phir jaake haath pilane, kisi ne bhookh hartal rakhi, usko juice pilana. Hum to sari umar yahi kaam kare. That is not leaders. That is you are being led by public. But if you can suggest to people what is required for them, that is the leadership, and that has what been tried to be set in by Prime Minister Modi. And the evidence of this is the Niti Aayog forum, which is organizing today's program. And therefore, in a nutshell, I would say that today Northeast is one of the preferred destinations for young startups from all over India, because it's a land of unexplored potentials. When every other place becomes saturated is Gujarat, Maharashtra, when the avenues are getting saturated, it is here that they come looking for. When Prime Minister started Startup India, Stand Up India, which is a beautiful program. It has a 5-year has a three-year period, which means that if a youngster is not able to put his mind in the kind of venture he has started, can change over without liability. And I said that day when this program was announced, I said this is can be done only by a government which thinks of other children as your own children. आप अपने बेटे को सेटल करवाते हैं, को ऑटोमोबाइल का गैरेज लगा देते हैं, और वो फिर 3 महीने के बाद कहता है, उसकी माँ कहती है कि बेटे को इतने नाज से पाला, एयर कंडीशन में कहाँ इसको गर्द और धूल में रख दिया. सो व्हाट डज द फादर से? ही डजंट से कि मैंने सारा प्रोविडेंट फंड जो था लगा दिया, अब छोड़ो पर मैं नहीं कुछ करता. ही सेड नो प्रॉब्लम, वी विल डू समथिंग एल्स. बेटे को रेस्टोरेंट खोल देंगे, खुद भी एसी में बैठे, कस्टमर को भी एसी उठाए. वो प्रोविजन स्टार्टअप इंडिया में था. वी वर द फर्स्ट टू इंप्लीमेंट इन नॉर्थ ईस्ट, एंड टू दैट वी थॉट वी शुड ऑल्सो अपीयर टू बी कॉन्ट्रीब्यूटिंग. फ्रॉम द मिनिस्ट्री ऑफ डोनर वी एडेड वन मोर incentive, that was a venture fund. The first lot of venture fund, whether Mr. Zoram Thanga remembers or not, was distributed in Mizoram. वो कहता तुम मुझे भूल भी जाओ तो यह कह तुमको मेरी बात और है, मैंने तो मोहब्बत की है. We got it deliberately. First, the Prime Minister's visit was there. The Chief Minister was Mr. Lalthanwala at that time. And we started out this because I realized one of the huge problems facing Northeast was youth exodus. Youth exodus happening in search of jobs, livelihood. So we thought we could at least contain these youth. And when we contained the youth, today I am amazed. We are getting startup groups from as far as Gujarat and Karnataka. In fact, sometimes I get worried. Even 3 days back, I had appointment with 2 small groups from Gujarat. So I was actually worrying ke kahin Northeast wale bachon ke liye khola hai, sare Gujarat wale hi le ja rahe hain, because they have realized, because they are very enterprising. But that is the kind of, you know, atmosphere or entrepreneurship friendly atmosphere which has been sought to be created by this ministry and this government. And people also now understand that there is much to learn from Northeast. And as far as Act East policy, which Sarvanandji was mentioning, I have firmly always believed that the successful accomplishment of Act East policy will happen only through Northeast. The gateway to Act East is via Northeast, because we have common culture, common food habits, common lifestyles, common preferences, common trade preferences. So if we have to do a successful business with the countries across the eastern borders, we have to strengthen our areas proximal to the borders. For example, if you have to sell a good, you have to cultivate. You cannot bring groundnut from Gujarat and sell it in Myanmar. You can't. Last year, I was sitting with the industry minister of Myanmar. Now also we are going to have the president on 27th. So at dinner, he asked me, what is this? In my bowl, there was dal. So he said, "Can I taste?" I said, "Why not, His Excellency?" He tasted. He said, "Can I have more?" I said, "No, you cannot have more." So he looked at me in amusement. What an inhospitable host. I said, "If you have more, you develop a taste. Do you know, we have committed buyership from Myanmar for dal, because they don't consume dal, pulses. India is a huge consumer of dal. So if you have to do trade with Myanmar, you have to sell a product which they consume. And that can be cultivated, developed, produced only in the northeastern states, only in Arunachal, Nagaland. So this is essential even from the point of view of India's larger concept of Act East. And I'm therefore glad to notice over here that I have to compliment Dr. Rajiv Kumar ji and Amitabh Kant ji in his absence, that all the 8 states have agreed to come forward to have a common roadmap for these sustainable goals. Because Northeast, as we know, has its own peculiarities, its own topographical peculiarities, geographical peculiarities. And notwithstanding that, I was going through the papers of the Niti Aayog. They have some very ambitious plans, like the East-West corridor from Porbandar to Silchar. The trilateral highway is also under planning, Manipur, Thailand, Myanmar, the Bangladesh, China. And not only this, I think, and of course, the novel concept of Eklavya Vidyalayas, which we used to have in our Sangathan, is now been, you know, here reincarnated as Eklavya Model Residential Schools, and there is a proposal to have 119 such schools by 2022. The Rural Livelihood Project is doing exceptionally well, ironically, in Mizoram. Of course, also in Nagaland, Sikkim and Tripura. But if these 4 states, they have actually excelled and proved to be a model for others. The budget has been, of course, not as much as we want, because that will, Delhi will always mange more. But let me point out over here, because even if you do a research study, you have to have correlations and comparative trials. Otherwise, your statistics and inferences are not recognized. Dr. Paul is there, who has been a teacher of research all his life. When we came in 2014 for Northeastern Council, the budget was only about 700 crore or 770. So I sought appointment with the then Finance Minister, Shri Arun Jaitley, and I told him that it was not even 100 crore per state. He smiled, and then of course he enhanced. And today we have more than 1400 crore. It's almost double. Donor was just 1,000 crores, 1,500 crore. I'm not saying that it is enough. What I'm saying is that almost 100% increase in 5 years by this government, in spite of all the constraints. And of course, I agree that 10% exemption thing is always up in our mind. And I would like that all of us would pursue it with the Finance Ministry. I had a word with the Vice Chairman also. I have spoken to all the Chief Ministers also. Because many of the ministries are not able to spend that 10%, and some of them do not have anything to spend in Northeast. So I, in my own, because I am not a financial expert, try to suggest to the Honorable Finance Minister Nirmala ji that we could either have the reappropriation of that 10% to another, and the Secretary made a beautiful draft for that, to another ministry which was capable of spending, or let the entire amount come to the donor ministry, and donor can be subjected to an audit. But then she said that this year the budget is already prepared. She would look into it seriously before the next year's budget. And I think all of us will have to continuously follow it up. Though the mandate of the Ministry of Donor is development of Northeastern region, which in a sense means infrastructure. But we have actually, in last 5 years, I'm glad to say that we have gone beyond our mandate. And very happily. Because the Ministry of Donor has become so close to the hearts of people of Northeast, including the donor and minister, that they think that he is responsible for everything in Northeast. Even if there is an earthquake, the government says the donor minister should travel, though it is the Home Ministry which looks out. So, but we are glad that we have developed that kind of, you know, belonging. And that is why, many a time when the chief ministers come and they say they want more money, so I politely tell them, see, the actual pronunciation of this word is donair, it is not donor. So, but I am glad that this kind of confidence and personal rapport we share amongst ourselves, that is why crossing our mandate, as I said, in the Guwahati University, we have set up Brahmaputra Study Center. Because I told the Vice Chancellor, I said, if I am concerned about the youth exodus, we have started Venture Fund. The other reason for youth exodus is the children going out for higher education. I said, you are one of the best universities in the country, which has its own legacy, the Guwahati University. But all your children are studying in Bengaluru and Pune. So Professor Zakaria was then the Vice Chancellor. He said, no, you have been a teacher yourself. So what do you think is the reason? I said, the reason is that you and I were not taught those two words which our children have been taught. I said, what is that? I said, that is job placement. So your university does not invite job placement. If you have a Brahmaputra center, like Kharagpur has an IIT which people are looking for, and now we have already started, first studies already been undertaken, initiated on prevention of floods, and so that we'll have scholars from all over, because this will be a unique center. Barua Hospital, for the first time in Northeast, you have DM and MCH. I'm sure Dr. Paul will realize the importance of what I'm saying. And it was not easy to get it through Medical Council of India. And what jugglery we did, not cheating, that we got it affiliated, because I was also looking after the Department of Atomic Energy, with the Department of Atomic Energy. And Department of Atomic, and the Tata Memorial Hospital is the only hospital in India which is not under the Ministry of Health, which is being administered by the Department of Atomic Energy. And it is running teaching courses there. And it's running teaching courses through a deemed institute called Bhava. So we got it tagged to Tata and therefore tagged to Bhava. And without going through Medical Council of India, we have now the second batch of MCH cancer surgery, onco surgery, and DM onco medicine. And that hospital was virtually lying unutilized. It was a private hospital by a Barua family. Bamboo, I am glad, has been said in deliberate by the Chief Minister of Mizoram, is going to be our mission not only for Northeast, for the national mission. And I wish somebody had pointed out that it is after 100 years when we placed this before Prime Minister Narendra Modi, Indian Foreign Forest Act was amended just for the sake of bamboo. Indian Forest Act, which is part of the Indian Constitution, was formulated in 1919 by the Britishers, so exactly after 100 years last year, to exempt homegrown bamboo from the clearance formalities, because that would generate livelihood. And we have started replicating it. Already, we have had a series of negotiations. We set up a three-day workshop in Jammu, and the Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir has provided us land to open a branch of CTBT there also, the Can and Bamboo Center, which is the first of its kind again on the Guwahati Shillong Road, which has become functional for the last 4-5 months. It's the first bamboo industrial park, you can say. And our bamboo natural park is coming up in the 6th scheduled district of Dima. So obviously, once it takes off, Northeast will not have, because it's a great reservoir of bamboo, that will not only generate revenue for Northeast, but Northeast will also become a replication model for the rest of India. And now everywhere I don't know, some of you may recall, last year there was a newspaper item in Mumbai, the two restaurants got gutted with fire. What is that, A1 or something, children would remember the name, A1 restaurant. That's because two youngsters had hit upon this idea of bamboo from Northeast. So they put up, because it's a cost-effective thing, they built a restaurant with bamboo on the terrace, because there's a land constraint in Mumbai on the top of the building. The other friend also built, but of course you have to observe the necessary fire safeguards, which of course will be taken care of. They would not have done that in a hurry, young innocent children, so the fire gutted both the restaurants. And today, just about 15 days back, I was, through a social media, sent a message that on the Pathankot to Jammu highway, three youngsters have put up a bamboo restaurant. I did not take it very seriously, but then so much was the passion of one of those boys that he came to look me up. And he said, sir, please visit us. So I think Northeast, as I say, is not only going to be the favored destination for startups from all over India, it is also going to provide raw material, resource material for setting up startup ventures in rest of India. So it will be going to be a two-way profiteering as far as entrepreneurship. On the one hand, we'll have entrepreneurs from outside coming here to set up their entrepreneurship. On the other hand, entrepreneurs setting up their entrepreneurship outside will look forward to resources from Northeast. And therefore, without taking much time, I hope, because it's already late by quite some time, all of us, I hope, would go back wiser from here, more resolved from here, more committed from here, and more determined to carry forward the mission which Prime Minister Modi has placed before us. Because to conclude, I could say that when Prime Minister Modi keeps talking of 5 trillion economy, it always occurs to my mind that whenever India becomes a 5 trillion economy, Northeast will be an essential component of that 5 trillion economy India. And by that linkage, when as 5 trillion economy, India becomes a part of the global economy, that would also make Northeastern states of India a part of global economy. So that is the kind of bright future that we look up to. On this optimistic note, thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.